Today, the session will be started by Dr. Shreya Anjalina Nisha. She was graduated in 2013 as a doctorate in the field of microwaves at Satyabhama University. She has more than 16 years of teaching experience. At present, she was working as an associate professor in Satyabhama Institute of Science and Technology, Chennai, and she has published more than 20 papers in national and international journals and conferences. She has published a book named as Optical Communication. Her field of interest is electromagnetic waves and antennas. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction, sir. Good morning to everyone. I'm Dr. Sahaya Anjali Nisha, member of IEI, associate professor from Satyabhama Institute of Science and Technology. And in line with yesterday class, I'm going to continue about the functions in Python using Google Colab. And why? Before that, I have to give small introduction about Python and Colab. Why we are running behind Python nowadays? Anyone, please? So actually, in data science, Python is taking vital role nowadays. Data science is placing more vital role in present communication system. Using data science, we can handle large amount of data at same time. So handling this huge amount of data using Python will be very, very useful. And in case of machine learning, Python will be acting as a good interpreter language between the virtual machines and other machines. And it's a very simple language. Like one person is starting to do the program means in C or C++ or Java or any language, that person has to learn from the basic syntax to classes, objects, everything. But in case of Python, we can write a program as it is what we are speaking. It's a written language so that it is easily handled by everyone. Huge community is nowadays using Python. So if we have any doubt, easily we can clear it. In case of web development, nowadays in YouTube, Netflix, Facebook, everyone is using Python as a backend developer because this Python is providing good libraries and framework in web development. And Python is placing more role in automation. In many purposes, we are using nowadays Python. Python programmers are paid with a high salary and it is having more growth, more jobs are available in Python. Therefore, we are all running behind Python today. And now, today in our class, we are going to use Python using Colab. Why I am going for Colab? Colab means collaboration. It is developed by Texas and it is a private site, but it is providing common platform for everyone and it is providing standard format. And for communication also, we can use this Colab. It is providing shared resources. See, Colab, for example, if I am creating or I am developing one project, means if I want to test my project, I have to create a running environment. But if I'm using Colab, I don't want to create a running environment. Directly, I can test my project using Colab. That is the advantage of Colab. Colab is a God's gift to all researchers, artificial intelligence development, and data analytics. So we can define Colab as an online workspace for module developments and producers, running on the open source Plone content management system. The main advantage of Colab is we don't want to install any software in our system. Suppose today we are going to do program using Python, but we don't want to install Python in our system. Directly, we can go to Google Colab and we can run our programs. And we can also run our program using Google servers. We can store our program using notebooks in Google Drive account. Notebook is nothing but Colab is based on Jupyter Notebook. So we are writing program in notebook only. And this Colab is providing three hardware oscillator types. The first one is central processing unit. This central processing unit is used for small modules and data set, and this is useful for design space exploration. The second hardware is graphics processing unit. This is used for medium to large modules and data set, and this is mainly used in image and video processing, and this is also used in CUDA and OpenCL. The recent development hardware oscillator in Colab is TensorFlow processing unit, and this is used for matrix computations. The mainly this TensorFlow processing unit is used in artificial intelligence system. And our topic today, we are going to see about function. Functions means what? In any program, we can define function as a sequence of certain statements in certain order. We will give the name to that function. When we are calling that name in our program, that particular statements are executed. So in Python, we are having four types of functions: user-defined function, built-in function, lambda function, and recursion function. See, in case of user-defined function, what are all the functions written by us in a system? That is said to be user-defined function. So this user-defined function is having the keyword def. So using this user-defined function, the intended block of statement or the huge amount of statement in the program is going to reduced by small number of statements. And next one is built-in function. So built-in functions are the functions already predefined in Python language. Around 68 functions are available in built-in function case. Some of 60 functions I have listed here. For example, apps means it will provide absolute value. Third is lambda function. So this is used for anonymous function. There is no keyword like def. It is, the keyword will be lambda here. And this is an inline function of C and C++, but we can't say it is fully inline function. Somewhat it is an inline function of C, C++. And the syntax for lambda function is lambda arguments colon followed by expression. In case of lambda function, we can use many number of arguments, but we can use only one expression. And the fourth type is recursion function. Recursive means what? When the function calls itself in a program, it is said to be recursion function. But at one point, we need to stop the calling of function. Because if we are not stopping that recursive, the iteration will be in thousands or lakhs or crores. So we need to stop. How we can stop this recursive? So to terminate this, we have to call the solution of the problem is downsides and move towards to the base case. Base case is nothing but at one point we have to stop the iteration without further continuation. So this is a small introduction about function. Now we will go to our hands-on session. Hello? Please everyone open Google. Using Colab, we can run our programs. So in Google, type Google Colab. Or you can type colab.research. See, I have already logged in, so directly it is logged in for me. Otherwise, we should log in using. Let's see here. I'm going to log use some other sub ID. 1 minute. It's very slow. Please wait for a minute. Go to Google Color. Double click here, Google Color. See this file. You have to sign in using Gmail or Google ID. I'm using this ID. Please everyone log in and try it. Since it is the Google Color, we don't want to install Python in our system. Directly run programs in Google Color by using Google IDs. See, you will get a screen like this. We have to select new notebook. I already choose the notebooks. If you are selecting this is the first time, you will get Python 2 notebook or Python 3 notebook. Please select Python 3 notebook. Otherwise, you can select Python 2 notebook also. I'm selecting new notebook. Since already I have chosen the notebook, it is not asking for me. For you, it will ask. We will get a screen like this. First, we will change the program name untitled into. Today, we are going to see about the functions in Python. I am giving the program name functions in Python. Just click here. It is saved. So, see, we are getting a screen like this. It is code. Using this code only, we are going to type our program. And this text is used for storing the information. For example, this is a code screen though. And this block is called a cell. If you want to add the cells, we can just click it. See, any number of cells added. We can delete it using this. Otherwise, we can move upwards and we can move downwards using this symbols. So this is the code. See, in this window, if I'm typing with this hash symbol, then this will be showing a green color. It is taken as just the commands. It is not going to run it. So this is just a command. We are storing the information. This is one way of storing the information. Otherwise, just click this text. Here also, we can type the information and store user defined. Functions we are going to see today. Okay, so like this we can store the information in Python. And first we will see about some user defined function. Already I told we have 4 types of functions: user defined, built-in, lambda and recursion. So in case of user defined function, the keyword is def. See, if the keyword is correct, it will show blue color. The keyword is def. I'm going to greet the person who is coming for our FDP in gate itself, in automatic gate. So I'm taking the function name as greet user. This is function name. Greet user is the function name. It should end with the parenthesis. For this program, I'm not going to pass any arguments. So we should aim colon. If everything is correct, I'm going to print within double quotes whatever we are giving is going to print. Welcome to FDP. Just run it. This program will be stored in our system. See, while running here, this side it is showing allocating, connecting. Next, it will become initializing and connected. So that means our system is now connected with the Google Drive, and this RAM and disk, see, RAM of 0.81 GB and the hard disk of 31.28 GB is used by me, and this is allocated by for me in Google Drive. So once I run this program using this symbol, we can run it. Otherwise, directly we can give a control enter also. To run this, simply give control enter. It is stored in my drive. So whenever I want to call this program, otherwise whenever the person is entering in the gate, I'm calling this program greet_user. We should not end with colon, because when we are defining the function, it should end with colon. When we are calling, we should not give colon. One person is coming inside, just he is showing some ID card. Then that program is running. It just show welcome to FDP. For example, if I'm calling two times this program, what will happen? Greet user. Greet user. Just I'm running this. Two times it will get display greet user. So this is the basic example for user defined function. And in this, I am not passing any arguments. Okay. Now I'm information. I'm going to pass the parameters. I'm going to pass the parameters in system. I mean in program. So for that, I'm going to take next example. We will take just I'm passing the information in. So first step in user defined function, initially without passing any parameter, we saw the program. Now the second stage, how to pass the parameters in function. First, I'm going to pass only one parameter for same user defined function. I'm taking def as the keyword, and I'm taking, now this is my function name. FDP is my function name. I'm going to give fname. This is my function parameter. It should end with the colon. If it is correct, print double quotes. See, within double quote, whatever is having, it will type welcome plus the name I'm going to give, fname plus 2FDB. Okay, this is my function. Now I'm going to call this function FDP with my name. My name is Nisha, and FDP, the next name Azam, like that means I'm giving. So when I'm running this, see, I'm getting welcome, and this FNAME, this parameter is replaced by Nisha, and it is displayed here to FDP. There is no space between here. If I want to give the space, we need to give the space within double quotes. If I'm giving space at this place, there won't be any space. If I'm giving the space within double quote, it will give the space. Check it. Run it again. See, welcome space Nisha space to FDP. So this is the way we can pass one parameter in user defined function. Next, we can pass parameter as default, that is default parameters also can pass in user defined function or any function. For that, the next program, please everyone type and check it. If you have any doubt, ask me. and in the next program I'm typing. Sometimes no parameter is passed, automatically this will take default parameter. So for example, again I am taking one program is defined and my program function name is cricket. I'm taking my function name is cricket and my function first parameter is country. This country is going to replace by the link parameter. I'm giving England. So this is my function name. Function should end with colon. If this is correct, I am printing the country. Which one I am going to give? Country plus. Just it will print the country space loves cricket. Okay, so this is the function I declared. Now I am going to call this function. Cricket is my function name. I am going to replace England by India. Okay, and next I am replacing, calling the same function, going to replace the England by Australia. The next step, I am calling the function again. And I am replacing the country without the names. I am not giving any parameter here so that this place automatically the default name England should be printed. Let's check. Again, I am calling the same function with other country, Pakistan. Now I am running this program. Let's check what is our output. See, first cricket is the function name. So when I'm calling the function as cricket here, the India is the parameter is going to replace the link parameter England that will be printed here. So India, this country is now India here, loves cricket. Then the next one, Australia is replaced in the function name of country, it loves cricket. Then see here, third line, I am not given any parameter. Simply one parenthesis I had given. So at this place, the default parameter is taken by the function cricket. The default parameter is what England is already stored. So England loves cricket. And again, Pakistan, I type this Pakistan with the parameter of function name cricket. It is printing Pakistan loves cricket. So this is passing a. So I didn't mention here. If you want, you can go to the text and type parsing. So if you are storing this later, when you are opening and seeing your programs, you can easily identify parsing default parameter. So this information we can type here. Okay. Then next, I'm going to pass list as the parameter. So three types we have seen, without any parameter, simple parameter, then passing default parameter. Now we will see about how we can pass list as the parameter. Okay. Now I'm going to pass list as the parameter. For example, we will take a list of car. What I did means I am taking a function called define. It is a user defined function. So whatever the function defined by us is known as user defined function. It is having the keyword def, and I am taking my car as the function name, and I am going to give the list of cars here. It's a function end with colon. The next, I'm taking one for loop. For yesterday, Sarah has taken about the loops. For cars in car. Sorry, for car in cars, I should take because I'm going to select the car from the list of cars. For car in cars. 1 minute. sorry for the disturbance. For cars in cars, I'm going to print the car. Okay, and give the list of cars. Because I am giving the cars as the parameter, so I should take cars as the keyword. Cars is equal to, I'm giving the list of cars. We should give the list of cars in double quotes. I'm taking my first car is BMW. Then Audi, we will take Audi. The next list is Toyota. The next list we will take Swift. Like that, many lists you can take. For list, we should not end with the colon. So this is the list of car. Just I'm running this program. There is no error stored in my drive. Now I'm going to call the function my car of cars. My car is function name, cars is a parameter. Just I'm calling this function. Let's check what is our output. See, simply it will put all the cars. If you want to add more cars, you can add like here within double quote. Next car is Mercedes. You can type Mercedes. So if you are running again, see there is an error. There won't be any bracket here, parenthesis here. Run it again. Five cars is getting displayed. So this is the list of cars. Like this, we can pass list as the parameter also in a function. The next one, we can pass return also, return values of parameter. Before that, I think sir has taken about what is the list in next yesterday's class. Suppose if you are typing car of 1, cars only I had given. If I am typing cars of 1, the second value will get display. It is a list because it will start from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Otherwise, if I am typing 4, I will get the name as the display. Otherwise, if I am giving minus 1, let's check what is the output. If you are giving minus 1, again the last value will get the display. If I am giving minus 2, the second last one has to display. So this is the easiest way we can call the list or the list in the function. So next we will see how we can use the return statement in the function. I told already if I am giving hash string, it will become a green layer. It will act as a statement here. It won't come under the program lines. How the return statement will be acting as a function, let's check. So if returning a value is again a very powerful function, sometimes in numerical function it is very useful. So for to square, if I want to calculate the square of very big number, it is difficult to calculate. So once we are storing the return function and if we are calling again, you can easily calculate the powers of large value or any other numerical calculation. So let's see how the return value can be used in user-defined function. I'm taking one user-defined function with the keyword of def, and I'm giving my power as the keyword. Going to take x as the parameter here. It is my function. Now I'm going to give return x is the power x power of 2. Okay. Then just I'm storing here. We'll check any error is there or not. There is no error. This function is stored. Now I'm calling my program as MyPower print MyPower of X. Just run it. It is showing error because I am not given any value for the X. If I am calculating, I want to calculate the power of 2. Replace the X by 2. This 2 will be replaced here and it will calculate the return value X. 2 power of 2. For example, I want to calculate the values for 199. It is not possible. We have to take calculate vendor. If we have stored the program already, just we are changing the value of X automatically. It will calculate and give us the power value of X. Like that, for any numerical calculation, we can use this return statement. And next is the keyword. How we can use keyword as a parameter in the function. So let's see about with an example. Keyword. I'm going to use keyword as a parameter. So again, same user defined program. Keyword is def. I'm taking the program name as my favorite car. I'm going to give the keywords. Keyword is car 1. This is my keywords, car 2, car 3. I don't know how many car values I'm going to give. Here just I'm giving only 3 cars. If we don't know the number of cars or number of the keyword or number of the parameter we are going to call, we have one more type of parameter that I'll discuss later. Now I'm taking here is 3 cars. There is no space. My favorite car is a function name and these are the keywords I had given and print. I'm going to print only my favorite car is. My favorite car is. Anything you can give here. Give the space. From the list, I'm going to print car of 3. Okay. This one I'm going to print. Let's check any error in the function. No errors. So I can call my keywords. Before that, I want to store my keywords in the name of car 1, car 2, car 3, car 4. For that, my favorite function, my favorite car of car 1 is equal to. I'm just giving BMW. Then car 2 is equal to then car 3 is equal to, because I had given only 3 cars here, which is equal unto just 3 car I had given. Now I'm running this program. See, I asked to print my favorite car is car 3. Here car 3 is Ben, so it is stored. If I am changing this order, car 3. If I am changing this order here, let's check anything is happening. No. So when we are using keyword as a parameter, if there is any change in the order of the list parameter, it won't affect the program. It may print the correct list from this. So already I told here I know only I'm passing 3 cars. If I don't know how many parameters I'm going to pass in the function, then we have to add one symbol as an asterisk symbol before the parameter in the function. That we will check again. It is known as arbitrary functions. So how we can pass arbitrary function here? We'll see that or about arbitrary functions. For example, I'm taking the user defined function. Same function I'm taking my favorite car, my favorite car of I don't know how many parameters I'm going to pass. So simply it is star cars. Okay, I don't know because how many parameters I'm going to pass. Any doubt? So now I'm going to print the same, but here I have to use square bracket for car of 3, and my favorite car list also I'm going to give. My favorite car, here I'm not giving a list, just storing the car values. BMW and okay, run it. Let's check what is happening in arbitrary function. See, it is showing error because I had given car of 3, but it is having the value 0, 1, 2. I have to give one more car name, otherwise change here, it is 2. Then again, it is showing some error in the print my favorite car. Why? It is cars. See, my favorite car is Audi here. It's a second car. So these are types of parameter passing in user-defined function. So we know that first function is the user-defined function. So in user-defined function, the keyword is def. This is in first example, without passing the parameter, simply I am greeting the user who is coming inside. So which is available between the double quotes will get print when I am calling this function. The second type, using one parameter, how we can pass the parameter. So that time we have to take, this is a function name and this is the parameter. This parameter is going to replace when I am calling the function FDP here. The third type, we can also use default parameter. If we assign a link parameter to the first parameter, and if we are not mentioning any parameter inside the parenthesis, then this will be taking a default parameter. Fourth type, we can pass list as the parameter. So by storing the list of parameters, we can call it. And the next type, we can pass return statement also can be used in the function. And the next one, we can pass keyword as a parameter. And if we don't know how many keywords or how many parameters we are going to pass, that time we can go for the arbitrary parameter to pass as the function. So these are the way of parameter passing in user-defined function. The next one is built-in function. I hope there is no doubt in user-defined function. The next is built-in function. So almost 68 built-in function is there. So simply I'll open my stored program because the time is running up. Go to file, open notebook. Already I stored this. See, these are the examples for using function. The next one is built-in function. See, I told 68 functions are there in predefined functions of Python. So some example we will see here because all are predefined function. So according to that function, if you are putting that keyword and it will automatically give us the result. So for example, to find the absolute value of one function, see ABS, it is the absolute value keyword. So I'm taking here, it is any doubt? See, x is equal to abs of 5 plus 3j. I'm going to calculate the absolute value of 5 plus 3j. So here I'm printing x. X means x is going to print the absolute value of 5 plus 3j. So I'm running this cell. We'll check what is our output. Actually, we should get the absolute value is 5 point something. We'll check whether we are getting or not. See, the absolute value of 5 plus 3j is 5.83. See, the next example for the absolute value, I'm taking the negative. When we are calculating the negative of minus 10.5, the absolute value must be plus 10.5. It is giving the value plus 10.5. So this abs is an already predefined function. So it is an example for built-in function. Next built-in function is all function. See, the all function takes the container as an argument. This built-in function returns true if all values in the Python iterable have a Boolean value. If all the values are Boolean, it will give the output as true. Otherwise, it will give the output as false. Let's check this. All of asterisk, colon, colon. This asterisk won't come under Python Boolean instruction. So we must get the output as false. Let's check it. It's taking too much of time. See, it is giving the output as false because this asterisk symbol won't come under Python Boolean value. The next, all the values, it's simply space I'm taking. It is all coming under Python Boolean value, so the output will be true. The next example for built-in function is all function. Any function, like all function, it takes one argument and return true if one value of the iterator has Boolean value. See, the difference between all and any is for all value. For all values, all the characters inside the bracket must be a Boolean Python expression. But in any statement, if any one of the Boolean value is there, it will give true. See, here 100, this 100 is a Boolean character, so it is giving true. The next example for built-in function is ASCII function. So it is also one of the important Python built-in function. It returns printable representation of Python object. Let's take a Romanian character ASCII of dollar symbol. So this dollar symbol is not coming in ASCII characteristics of Python. So it is giving this slash, two backslash. The error is represented as one first backslash and the second backslash is used to escape from that. It is showing some error. That means it is saying it is non-ASCII characteristics of Python. Next example, I'm running. See here, U is the ASCII character, saying U is printed, but this dollar symbol is not an ASCII character, so something is printed. This backslash is representing it is not an ASCII character in Python. R is an ASCII character, it is printing R. The next example for built-in function is bin, that is binary. It converts the integer into binary string. For example, I'm taking binary of 7, it is giving 0B11. If I'm taking 0.7, it has to give the error because the floating point binary functions are not available in Python. The next example for built-in function is bool. Bool converts the value into pool. For example, see, pool of 0.7, it converts, it's a true Boolean in Python. And byte array returns the Python array, a given byte size. I'm giving byte array of 4. So our output will be 4 array and CHR of character. This is used to find the character value, ASCII character value in Python. For example, I'm taking character of 65, it is A. and character of 9, it will be / t, and length is one of the important parameter used to find the length of the string which is given in the function or anything. I'm taking my list is equal to hello. Hello means 5 letters are there. So the length of this my list is equal to 5. So when we are calculating this, x is equal to length of my list. My list is having hello word. Hello is having 5 characters. And minimum function returns the items values or the item with the lowest value. See, minimum of 5, 10. It should give the output as 5. Is here minimum of 120, 90. So output must be 90. And the power function, last in user defined function, we use return value to calculate the power. Other than that, already one input function is there in Python is power of x. Now I'm giving power of 4, 3. It will calculate 4 power 3. So 64. If you are giving 5, 2, run it. 5 power 2, it is 25. We have to get the answer. It is 25. So these are some of the example of built-in function and multiple. And the third important function in Python is lambda function. This is mostly used in AI. Already I told it is an anonymous function. And we don't have the keyword def here. Here the keyword is lambda. And see, the syntax of lambda is lambda arguments : expression. We can pass any number of arguments, but the expressions will be 1. For example, I'm taking x is equal to lambda, n is 1 argument, and the expression is n star n. I'm passing print of x of 5. 5 will be taken as n here. So my output must be 5 into 10, 50. This is one parameter passing. Here I am passing 2 parameters, m, n. But the expression is 1 using m, n. I'm taking here m by n and passing 10, 2. 10 will be taken as m, 2 will be taken as 2. So my output must be 10 by 2 is 5. Third example, I'm taking 3 parameters with one expression, m, n, p. I'm passing 3 values. So m will be 2, n will be 3, and p will be 2. So 2 into 3 into 2, you have to get the answer. It is 12. So lambda is used for anonymous function. Keyword is lambda, arguments, colon, followed by expression. Any number of arguments we can use, but there must be one expression. And why to use lambda function? The power of lambda is better when we use them as anonymous function inside another function. So for example, calculating the area of the circle, same program using 2 ways I have written here. See, the first program in user defined function, I'm going to use this lambda function. So define area of radius r. I'm using again return lambda of pi : this is lambda function keyword, one parameter pi, pi star r star of 2. I'm just giving circle area is equal to area of 2. So first, what will happen? Area of 2, r is replaced by 2, and this 2 will come here. Lambda will get, this function is calculated as pi in, pi will be there, we don't know the value of pi, 2 into 2. So pi into 4 will be stored here. Again, I'm calling the function circle area of 3.14. Now this pi is replaced by 3.14. When I'm running this, I'm getting 12.56. This is one way of writing program. The same program I have written using 2 parameters. So we need to represent here 2 values. We'll get the same answer as 12.56. Area of the circle will become 12.56. The fourth function is recursion in Python. Recursion means calling the function from itself. So suppose this is a one user defined function. First we have saw that define greet of x and print hello. When I am calling this greet function, every time this will print hello. If I'm calling lakhs of times, it will print lakhs of times hello. But at one point, we need to stop to print this hello. For that, we can going for regression. We are using the base case, that is using some loops. We can reduce the number of one variable to zero, and at particular point, we can stop printing of this hello. So for example, I'm taking Fibonacci series using regression in Python. See here, I'm defining one user defined function DEF. Fibonacci series, FIB is taken as a function name, and three parameters I'm passing here, N1, N2, N. What is Fibonacci series? It will start from 0. 0 plus 1, answer is 1. That answer 1 plus the previous value, 1 plus 1, answer will become 2. Then that answer 2 plus previous value, 1 plus 2, 3. Like that it will go. Suppose I want to print only 10 number of Fibonacci series value or 50 number of Fibonacci series value. I have to stop this program. For that only we are using regression. See here. So if I define the function, first I'm checking the loop value. I'm using if loop here. If n is equal to 0, it will stop the program using the keyword return. Okay. Otherwise, it will continue the loop. This return is used to here to stop the printing of the program or to stop the loop. If not, if n is not equal to 0, it will calculate N1 plus N2, print RES value. And again, it will take the function is assigned as second value, the result, and the loop is reduced N minus 1. So N1 here, first value, second value. This is how many number of iteration I need to print. Okay. Then every one is reduced. The previous value, the result, and one loop is reduced here. So this is one regression function. I want to call this regression function in this program. Before that, I need to initialize my values. First value I'm taking A is equal to 0. Then the second value B is equal to 1. This N I'm taking how many inputs or how many numbers I need to print. So first value will print A, second value will print B. And this is again assuming the function with FIB. 0, 1, n minus 2 means 2 values already I printed. 10 values I want to print means 2 values already I printed. So it will take 8. And this function is going to assume here. Then this loop expression will continue till n is equal to 0. Now I am running this program. I want to print 15 values. See, 15 values are printed. First value 0, 1, 0 plus 1, 1. Then it will take N2, RES, and N minus 1 is taken as 30. Like that, this loop will work it out. And whenever N is becoming 0, that is after printing the 15 values, N is equal to 0, this return statement will stop the program. This is said to be a recursive function in Python. Some two examples I had given here. See, function, it is an example program for the function that accepts string and calculate the number of uppercase letter and lowercase letter. See, string define is the user defined function. String test is my function name. I'm going to take the input as yes, any variable you can take. First, I am assuming one variable. D is equal to uppercase, initially I am assuming 0, and lowercase is also initially I am assuming 0. For the characters, these are the variables, anything you can take. It's a character. For character in this string, first we will check whether it is upper. If it is upper, it will take 0 plus 1. Otherwise, if it is lower, it will take 0 plus 1. If it is not upper, it is not lower, maybe it's a space. So that time it will simply pass the loop. Again, it will go to the loop. So I have to print first original string, whatever available here, and number of uppercase letter and number of lowercase letter. For example, we'll take for faculty. So I'm having 1, 2, 3, 4 uppercase letter and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 lowercase letter. So my original string is this FDP for faculty. I'm having 4 uppercase letter and 13 lowercase letter. One example I have taken as Python program takes the number of takes a number as a parameter and check the number is prime or not. So here I have to give my original text. So this is the function name, original text, and it will check, it will first find the total number of strings to compare the first string with the last string, second string with the second last character, third character with the third last character, like that. To want to compare it, it will just check first length of the value. Sorry, ma, it's a palindrome. This is a palindrome program. So here that we have to check the first string, compare the first string with the last string, second character with the second last character, third character with the third last character. If everything is same, it will print it is a palindrome. So I'm taking same type of user defined function. It's my function name, my original string. This is my original string, which is going to place here. It will check the left, it will take the left position as 0 and the right position is total. LEN of string means length of string 5 minus 1, 4. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Fourth value is the last, and this will compare 0, 4, and 1, the second last character. Like that, it will compare. Let's check the output. So Nisha is not a palindrome, so it is giving the output as false. Suppose I'm giving because it's a case sensitive. I'm running. See, both are same. Sorry, Malayalam is an example for palindrome. It is giving the output as true. And this program is used to find the prime number. So if prime number means what? The number which is having only two factors. It has to divide by one and it's the same number. So for that, I'm checking if n is equal to 1, I'm finding the factors now. And if that factor is only 1, it will false. Factor is 2, it will type true. So just I'm taking 4. 4 is not a prime number. We have to get the output as false. And I'm taking 23. It's a prime number. So we have to get the output as well. Please try this program. And this is for calculating the Pascal triangle. Pascal triangle means 1. And the down value will be calculated by the upper triangle value. So this one, if it is 1, assume here 0, 0. So this one will be 0 plus 1 and 1 plus 0, 1. Then 0 plus 1, 1. 1 plus 1, 2. 1 plus 0, 1. Like that, the Pascal triangle will go. So this is the example program for Pascal triangle. So that's it about the functions. Basically for Python, we have discussed about user defined function and in that how the parameters are passed using without passing parameter, parameter value and default parameter, list is the parameter, return parameter, keyword is the parameter and arbitrary parameter. And 68 built-in functions are there, and lambda functions is mostly used in AI. Lambda function for anonymous function, And finally, we have discussed about recursion. So I'm closing my session till that. Any doubt? Hello, sir.
Hello, good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, it was a very beautiful and very well explained session. You have got a good knowledge of Python.
Thank you, sir. Thank you
for your presentation, first of all. And I have two small doubts.
Yes, because sir. Not
regarding your explanation is very clear. No doubt from your explanation. The first is the IDE. Which IDE are you using, ma'am? Because I could not attend the yesterday session.
No, sir. It is simply a collab, sir. Directly, we can open Google Colab. We don't want to install Python in our system. Directly, we can open Google Colab and we can create a notebook there.
Okay, that's really good.
Yeah, we don't want to install any software when we are using Google Colab. That is the main advantage of Colab.
Very nice. And the second is it possible to get the recording of this session for our further reference?
Yes, sir. They are recording, sir. We will give it to you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Ma'am, Nisha, ma'am, can I answer to his question, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Recording. Dear participants, dear faculty members, the recording of the session will be uploaded in the Satyabhama IEI YouTube channel. The link will be shared in the WhatsApp group where you have joined. Is that fine, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you very much.